We've talked to early years. Anything you'd like to say, maybe more about the present, your experiences are chasing, and we know it's changed. We have a lot of people out there now who were brought in by Twister, and it's just so much different.
Yeah, I think, and of course, chasing has gone through several cycles here over a period of time. I'd say the earliest chasers in the 1970s, in particular, were basically meteorology students, people working on their degrees, learning how to use Doppler. So there were very few original, well, non-meteorologist chasers like myself. 1980s, National Weather Service forecasts improved. The media became interested. The media started realizing, gee, we can get live action pictures because the forecasts are so good. We can put our trucks out there. We can take something and send it back to the studio. 1990s, computers became more useful, more accurate. Costs came down. People were taking computers out in the field, motels primarily, before Wi-Fi came along. And of course, Twister came along as a movie, and that generated a lot of interest from amateur chasers who thought it was easy to go out every day and see four or five tornadoes and didn't realize in some cases you had to drive thousands of miles and you had to spend a lot of money on gas over many days before you were lucky, maybe, to even see a tornado. So it's not easy to do when you're really out there. But at that point, I'd say the majority were not meteorologists. Probably in the 90s, more than half, or many more than half, were amateur chasers like myself. And 2000, we had the storm tours came along. Initially, I was not very much favorable towards storm tours. I thought this was maybe a little bit unnecessary risk to put people into. But then I kind of grew around to where I thought that maybe they did serve a purpose, and this is mainly educational. The numbers of different people going on these tours, learning about storms, and going back home and passing on what they've learned to other people, I would say it's a great learning tool for a lot of people who have been on the storm chases, and in a sense, it helps get the word out that what the danger is and also how to find them. But I think the main difference, the main changes that have taken place for me, and for I think a lot of the early chasers, like particularly Al Mohler and Doswell and myself, we were interested in the whole structure of the storm. We didn't need to be under the wall cloud, in the bear's cage, right next to the tornado when it comes down, getting video of flying mud and wind and debris, which, by the way, doesn't change that much from tornado to tornado. It's pretty much the same thing. But being close to have bragging rights and to maybe sell it for a higher price to some media group and say, here's where I was and here's how much danger there was and so forth. When we started, and we still feel this way, we're interested in the whole structure of the storm. We want to get wide angle shots of the anvil, the tower going up, the inflow band, the wall cloud, the strided bands going up the column of clouds, seeing the boiling and churning in the cumulus, getting a sense of what the whole storm is like, a living organism almost. We get the tornado, fine. We zoom in on it, fine. But it's a sense of the beauty, and we see, and each one is very different. Each storm really has a character of its own. Taking pictures, slides, telephoto, that's more of our interest. The people who get in close, the people who are taking chances, getting dramatic pictures, yes, but it is very limited. They can't be close and be far back at the same time. If they're close, they're committed to the drama of the churning winds and the debris and the dirt and the roofs lifting off buildings, which is interesting to see. I will concede I enjoy watching it. But it's not the kind of a thing I'm apt to look back at again and again and again. What I will go back to and want to see repeatedly is the whole storm, the anvil, the wall cloud, the structure. I want to see that magnificent storm that's going to produce a tornado. For me, that's why I chase. It's a natural wonder, not a dangerous wonder. And that's the difference, I think, between myself and a lot of the veterans and the chasers and many of them are more the amateurs who are imitating people like who drive the battle tanks into the storm. they think, gee, it's exciting, it's fun, I think I'll do it. Danger's coming there, and people are going to lose their lives because they're not looking at it, what I would say is looking at it in the right way.
The only time, I chased approximately 20 years, the only time we ever met at a tornado was Hodges. Could you give a little more information about how we, well, not so much how we got together, but just of the Hodges tornado? You had Edgar Kike from Canada with John for what, a couple of years he was there.
Hodges, Texas, 1989, May 13th. It was a beautiful storm. And that's where one of the few places where I ran into quite a few people I knew. It was, of course, Tim Marshall, Phil Sherman, Roy was there, Doswell and Moore. And it took its time to form. It was an open country. I remember first thing I saw was the rotating dust on the ground underneath this very high vortex, and it started to come down very slowly, very gracefully. We had plenty of time to set up cameras. There was large hail falling to the east of us, not over us. Fortunately, we saw 2 and 3 inch stones later, close to Hodges. And it was just a beautiful day. It was a kind of a day when everything came together. Nobody was injured. It was just a classic photographic gem. And that's the kind of thing that we're looking for always. Chasers don't want to see damage or houses or cars flying through the air. They want to see structure. They want to see the storm. And we did that day with Hodges. One of the prettiest storms, I think, of that year. There are many, many pictures of video taken. You'll see a big wedge tornadoes. Very turbulent, very large, very dangerous, very ominous looking. But for really photographic quality, the kind that you want to look at on a calendar, you really want the thinner, the narrower kind. Some of the ones in Colorado are stunningly beautiful. Isolated cigars, funnels come down the ground. Beautiful contrast, not wrapped in rain. It's like a monument, like almost carved in granite, just put in the ground for you to take pictures of. So those are the ones that I think chasers really enjoy seeing. Those are the kinds that we'll look at again and again over the years and say, gee, I'm glad I was there.
I know at the beginning of it, we were all at the same location, but you decided before the tornado touched down, you wanted to get a little bit better overall perspective.
Oh, right, right.
How far did you leave?
I drove about 2 miles further east, 2.5 miles. And I knew I was going to be very close. I wanted to see the whole storm. That's exactly why I drove away. I want to see cloud-based ground. I want to see this thing that looked like it came out of the Wizard of Oz, from cloud to ground. I knew if I was closer, it would be more churning, more dramatic, but then I wouldn't see the whole formation. For me, that was important. So Edward Kike was with me at that time. We drove away, and we stopped, and we both got a good set of pictures.
Yeah, because at first I couldn't figure out why you would want to leave there, but after the way the tornado developed, when it got in a real long ropey state, I couldn't get it all in viewfinder, so I had to pan up and down.
Right.
Where, you know, you had a choice. You could get the whole thing if you wanted to zoom in a little bit, you could do that.
But, you know, it's not like, it's a matter really of preference, because I very much enjoyed seeing your video and others. It was close up, but it was something I couldn't see. I couldn't be where you were. So here you're looking up and you're seeing the turning column going up in the sky. I thought that was neat. Yeah, if a chaser could be in 3 places at the same time, I'm sure he or she would be. But in this case, I had to choose, and I had to get away from it where I could see it. But when I make that choice, then that's it.
Yeah, I saw my first tornado in 1981, May 22nd, at Cordell, Oklahoma.
Oh, yeah.
I never had a SLR camera. I'd always use Instamatic, but I wasn't chasing tornadoes.
That was a big wedge, as I recall.
But we were close to it. I had met up with Eric and at that time the Sound Chase team, so we were probably a mile, maybe a little closer to it. And I was just, it was such a phenomenon. I snapped, and I didn't, in those days, I didn't take a lot of photographs. I just, you know, and I was told, many people told me after that, you know, just take as many as you can, just snap them.
Well, in those days, you had a limited number of pictures on a spool of 35 millimeter film. You tended to husband what you had.
And I remember that the most disappointing thing, I don't know, I took quite a few, But I got home, and a few weeks after I had them in for development, I came back. I had some good ones, but about half of them were double and triple exposed. And being a SLR camera, I couldn't figure it out. I never had, but somebody told me maybe the winding mechanism had tore the advanced part or something.
Yeah.
So some of them didn't completely, move out of the way. So when I had taken them, I'd get three. That's the only thing I could ever figure out, but it was the only time it ever happened to me like that was on my first tornado, which I could have gotten maybe some, I don't know if I could have done a whole lot more, but I could have had a lot more what I took.
Well, there's a distinction really between being there and buying the film or the video from an armchair somewhere hundreds of miles away and looking at it and trying to imagine it. For me today, I take digital cameras out. I try to get the best pictures I can. They're not nearly as perfect or as accurate as some of my friends who have lots of equipment that have invested thousands of dollars in cameras. But that's okay. If I get some reasonably good pictures, that's good for me. That's good enough. At the same time, it's something that takes me back to the moment, because I'm not only seeing this small image on a TV screen or a laptop of something I'd photographed, but I'm remembering what it was like that day, where I was, the people I saw, the wind blowing and gusting, the thunder, the rolling clouds overhead, the sense of being part of a great event going on. That's what links, what a photograph or video links me to, and for me it's a much broader experience. I'm sure it is for you or for any storm chaser. It's just a bonus, you might say, to having been there.
Yeah, because like I say, when we would bring film back or whatever, the anticipation, and then when you got a good shot,
yeah,
you could always remember where you were at and how you felt. You know, it brings back emotion that,
yeah,
you know, at the time I'm shooting these, a lot of time you don't have time to really enjoy it or think about it.
And also, I think it lately anyway, it makes a difference it to be at a historic event like El Reno. Or another day's Harper, Kansas in 2004. There were other storms I was on. Beatrice, Nebraska, 2005 or 2006, I believe it was. Being where, unfortunately, damage occurs, maybe people lose their lives. And by the way, the El Reno tornado was the first one I've ever seen that actually caused fatalities. That was my 57th year of chasing. So every other one I've seen either caused little or no casualties, injuries, or was just over open country. And I think people get the wrong idea sometimes if they think of, the Moore, Oklahomas, and the El Renos, and maybe Grand Island, Nebraska one time. Any of the major cities have had deadly tornadoes. They think this is kind of the thing that everybody is looking for. Not at all. And most of us, what we're looking at out there is, again, something that's a wonder of nature. It doesn't hurt anybody. That's perfect. The storm I saw last year, April 14th, near Geneseo, Kansas, I believe it was, went up to Salina. Quarter mile wide on the ground, F4. It was on the ground for, I don't know, 40 miles. It came right next to me. I watched it as it went by me within a mile and a quarter. I got a nice video of it. It went right by. Everybody saw it coming. Nobody was injured. It was just like it was picture perfect, made for chasers to take pictures of. That's the kind of thing we're looking for. And that's something that will live for a long time up here and in your camera, on your television.
Yeah, because I remember we talked after you came back, and you told me that was something you'd always wanted to do, was catch one, not 5 minutes or, in a rush, but you could just kind of position yourself and get it from a distance and catch it coming towards you and then moving away.
That's literally my dream tornado. And I'm glad I lived long enough to see that. I was 74 years old at the time when I saw it. But, it was one that it was just perfect. And many of my friends were there, took pictures. One of the things that's fun for me to come back from a storm trip like that is to then go on the internet, go to the email, and read the accounts of all the other people that were there and see their pictures of the same thing I was looking at. It's a feeling of like a community through the internet, which we didn't have decades ago, where we can share experiences. and the sense of like you were part of not only a historic event, but you were in a group of people that many of them you knew, but you didn't even know where they were there. Everybody's focusing on the tornado. Later on, we find out, oh, you were there, you were there. That's kind of fun.
Storm track probably would be very interesting. I think you, was it 78 that you, well, you met, who was, you met somebody at a conference, right?
Randy Zipser, and we initiated the idea of the storm track kind of together. This was in the 1977 at the Omaha conference, the severe storms conference that the AMS had at various places around the country. That particular year was Omaha, and the company that Randy worked for at that time was the sponsor of part of the show, a part of the conference, and they asked me to bring along 50 or 60 prints of storms I'd taken pictures of over the years, because they wanted to put them up on the back wall of the main conference room as kind of just something as a something to look at for the members of the conference. Well, I did so, and was overwhelmed very soon after I put them up with all the people came up to me and said, we want copies. Can we order them from you? Can we get them? I didn't know how much to charge. I wasn't prepared for that, so I got a couple large sheets of paper, and I was writing down names and addresses and estimating the cost or saying I'd get back to them. And so I got the idea at that point that, gee, photography of storms is interesting to people, and especially so, and some of them are willing to pay money to get copies. So, kind of as a result of the Omaha conference in 77, and while we were there, Randy and I were there, I got the idea for maybe a newsletter, maybe something that storm chasers should know about, should share information. I could, in my early issues, talk about, hey, here's how to copyright your material. Do you know that it has value? People want it. So I thought maybe other things that chasers might want to exchange, experiences they've had, which side of the storm to be on, what highways are good, just general information. So I started the newsletter. This is the first copy, December 31, 1977, and my earliest cartoons were done on stencils, not pen and ink as I did later. So this is a stencil drawing, actually. And this is the last issue, 25 years later. Tim Marshall was in charge of that. And that's at that point it went digital, or went on the internet, and that's where it is today. So 25 years of storm track, paper copies, from 1977 to 2001. And it was a lot of fun to work on. It was a good deal of work. The drawings took a lot of time. That was before I was reproducing, or Tim was reproducing, actual photography. So I would get somebody's pictures of a storm, and I would try to sketch it to make it really show out and stand out on my newsletter. But I had about 230 subscribers when I turned it over to Tim in 1985. I thought that the newsletter needed a fresh approach, and it would benefit from someone who was a meteorologist and had his own perspective on it. So I thought it was time for it to grow, and he took it over. And then since then, it's been Tim Vasquez. Now I suppose there are thousands of readers on the internet all around the world, apparently.
When you started, or in the time you were doing the newsletter, did you ever have any help much, or did you need help, or you just did it all by yourself?
No, I this newsletter I did all myself, and occasionally my wife, my daughter would help me assemble it, but most of the time, if I had, say, 100 subscribers, and I did it the old-fashioned way, I would Xerox my pages, then I would just take every shelf, every counter in the basement, and I would lay down sheet, 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 number 7, sheet, 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 number 6, number 5, number 4. I needed to do that because in some cases, I had trouble early on with the copy machines collating. They would constantly jam. I gave up on that. It was a lot of handwork. And no, I did it all myself. And one of the reasons I did turn it over to Tim was, as my daughter was progressing through high school, I wanted to be available more for her to help her with schoolwork and things like that. I didn't want it to take up so much of my time. So that was how I did it.
Have you ever had any period of deer or so that you didn't chase?
Only 1966, when I was saving annually for the honeymoon. That's the only year I didn't chase. That was when Topeka was hit. So I've always kind of regretted that, but well, that's just what happens. This is a postage stamp taken from one of my photographs of Movadas clouds near Marysville, Kansas, which I took in 1971. This is part of the Cloudscape series of 15 weather photographs that was issued in 2004. And I only happened to take this picture because I got stuck in the mud that day. I was racing east across northern Kansas, heading for a high-risk area where I wanted to be. And I was going down this farm dirt road, and on the other side going up the hill looked like blacktop. Well, they had just tarred it, apparently, in preparation for the blacktop, because when I got on that thing, I was going uphill, and I started sliding all over the place, went right into the ditch. I got out of the car. I stood up next to my car. Just standing still, I was sliding downhill. So I had to go to the farmer to get a tractor, pull me out. He had trouble. He initially slid on the road. He had to get his tires on the opposite bank. Well, he got me out. I missed the 25 or 30 tornadoes that were east of me. No one seriously injured, just mostly beautiful tornadoes. But I missed it. Had I not missed it, I wouldn't have been close to the back side of the storm, the anvil, and seen some of the best Mammoth clouds I've ever seen. So I took these pictures. I didn't think much more about it until sometime in 1994, I think it was Mike Mogul, got the idea to sell the idea of weather clouds to the Postal Service. And he remembered my Mammatus. So he called me up and said, "Say, we might like to use some of your pictures." So I sent this in with some others. They chose this one. So that's the one that got published. And that's the one that basically I took almost by accident on a day that I otherwise would have been somewhere else if I had had a choice that day. So that was kind of fun. But I must add that while some of my friends and storm chasers have been impressed by this notoriety, I believe it was also the same year that the Postal Service came out with a stamp dedicated to Bugs Bunny and other cartoon characters for sale. So considering the company that I had to share that year, I don't know that it was so special, but it was still nice. This is a set of 6 volumes of Storm Track that were planned for use in a graduate course of study at Colorado State University about storm chasing. And I received a nice letter from Don Burgess, and this is considered to be a background work for the course. Now, I can't confirm it was actually used, but it was the intent that it was to be used. So that was kind of interesting. This is one of the earliest documents that there were on detailed storm chasing. The other part of educational benefit to the wider community, possibly, was an article that I was invited to write for the AMS Bulletin. And this was about the tropical storm David in September 1979 that came through this area of the country. And what was of special interest was I got a hold of some aerial photographs taken by the state police flying over the Pickett Shopping Center out west of us, and there were indications of suction vortices on the ground. And I could see the damage track right away, and I thought, that's interesting. So I wrote it up initially for Storm Track. And apparently Ted Fujita got a hold of the information. He said that this was the first time that a suction vortex had been reported and verified from a tropical storm or a hurricane. So that made it kind of special. So I wrote it up in as much detail as I could, as if it were scientific paper. And it went through peer review, and it had many revisions, but finally it did get published in the AMS Bulletin, which I was kind of pleased with. I don't know how many non-meteorologists published there, but what was, of course, special was not so much who was doing it, but was the fact of the storm. Suction vortices, this far inland from a storm that came up the coast several hundred miles, and was still producing these things. So that was kind of interest to the community, and it was kind of fun to work with. I don't chase hurricanes as much as many of my chase friends do, certainly people like Jim Leonard, Tim Marshall. I've gone out on a few chases. I've gone as far as the Florida Panhandle on one chase. But most of the time, what I'm looking for is not the wall cloud, or not the wall cloud, the eye wall, because that's so difficult to find, and to be in just the right place to get a motel room when they're all sold out days ahead, and to pick the right place and hope it comes over. Not only that it comes over you, but it's daylight when it does so. The odds of that happening can be very expensive, and you can drive many, many miles and it'll never happen. So I chase the outer rain bands looking for the brief tornado that may form in that formation. And those are very hard to find. I've had very little success along that line. But one particular storm I remember that I went chasing on, I wound up at Elizabeth City, North Carolina. This was for Hurricane Isabel back in 2003, September the 18th. And I was at the Holiday Inn Express there, and the storm came in. The eye wall was just, maybe 30 or 40 miles to the west of us, so we were in the maximum circulation side. Watched the trees bending, and I got a few trees falling, the wind flying through the air, and the rain blowing. But the one thing that was special about that day was not what was outside the storm, and they had the windows, of course, taped with the masking tape to keep them breaking. But inside, there were a few people gathered in the lobby. The power was out. People were just kind of keeping themselves occupied and kind of just watching the storm. There was a fellow in there with a guitar, and he was strumming at the guitar, and he was singing some old folksy songs from the coastline. It was fishermen songs or others. And there was a young boy about 10 years old. He was fascinated with this guy playing the guitar. And the only sound in this otherwise quiet room, other than the wind blasting outside, the rain, and the world going upside down, was here's this fellow strumming the guitar, and people were listening to the music. And it was like you were in two different worlds. There was the world of destruction and threat outside, and a little world of insular security, everybody together, and everybody on one wavelength. And we were just in another place there besides the storm. It was just a special moment. But one thing I'd like to mention in particular, which is of interest, I saw a book review of this particular book, The Invention of Clouds, and it's by Richard Hamblin, H-A-M-B-L-Y-N, and it has an interesting account here of a young fellow, a name of Luke Howard, who basically invented the names of clouds. He came up with the notion back in 1802 or 3. He was an amateur member of an amateur English society of engineers and meteorologists and stargazers before there were any, just people who were interested in the weather. And he invented the terms of cumulus, cumulonimbus, stratus, terms like that, and he'd explain what he had come up with, and he wanted people to maybe use these in the future because it would help to standardize everybody's perception of what they were looking at. And his idea, his names of clouds, caught on rapidly. And in fact, Goethe was one of his main fans who wrote a poem about the four cloud types. So he gained quite a bit of notoriety. What was interesting, in particular, about Luke Howard, this amateur meteorologist, amateur scientist, was that he was a Quaker. And that happens to be what I am also. I'm a Quaker. Although I've served in the Army, I'm not particularly a doctrinaire Quaker, but that's my family background. So what's interesting to me is, it was a Quaker in 1803 who invented the names of clouds, and a Quaker in the last half of the 20th century and the 21st, who's the first storm chaser. So I think of it as kind of an interesting symmetry. Seems like the Society of Friends was at the beginning and the middle of storm chasing. And who knows, 20 or 30 or 50 years from now, maybe we'll make a name for ourselves again.
Okay. We haven't touched on your drawings, though. Everybody's just, you know, they think drawings. You do such a great job, and I'd like to kind of hear your thoughts about, because you get a lot of accolades. People always, you know, they'll post sometime on Facebook, you know, some of your old drawings from Storm Track days and stuff like that.
Well, yeah, I've enjoyed drawing the sketches, the funnel funnies, for instance, for Storm Track. For me, that's not work. That's just a labor of love. I enjoy characterizing scenes I've seen, presenting them in hopefully a humorous way that other chasers will identify with. It's just that I have the ability to do so, and I like to use it as much as I can. And while I was doing Storm Track, that was something that was always fun to kind of create the idea. Many of them, though, were given to me. I must credit Tim Marshall and some other people gave me some of those ideas. So it's not all my work, but much of it is, and it was fun to do.
It just occurred to me, the time that a major chase for us in Virginia was, what, 2011, April of 2011, they had that massive outbreak in Carolina before the big one in Alabama about 2 days later.
That was a high-risk day.
Yeah.
Right.
We had contacted each other earlier, I think the day or two before.
You came down almost to the border or just over
I came over the border, got as close to north of Rocky Mount, which there was a significant tornado that people shot video of, and you were further south, but
I was all the way down to Fayetteville that day, and I only had one chance at the very fast-moving storms, one that came up, it was southwest of the road that goes southeast from Fayetteville. I forget the places it was going to, but that storm was coming up, and it was at one time tornado-warned, and I was just east of it, and I watched it as it passed over the road, and it had changed so much in just since it was warned. It was now mostly just rain-wrapped, and it really didn't have any of the traditional features. It didn't have the inflow band, didn't have a wall cloud, nothing like that. But it was a dark mass of rain and basically the heavy clouds overhead. And that's how I think most of them were. Well, it was moving at almost 60 miles an hour. So the angle of the road that I was to it, I couldn't keep up with it. I had to go at right angles to try to catch up to it. And then there were others popping on either side of me, draining away some of the energy of that one. So I was bouncing from one to the other. And there were like, I don't know, 40 or 50 tornadoes, it seemed like, maybe more, just in North Carolina. I didn't see one. But just an example, just as Roy was saying, as you were saying, it's sometimes you can have many opportunities and things are changing so rapidly and they're moving so fast that you don't see anything. Or you can have a day, you can have two or three or four, and you can pick the storm and see the right one and get some great photography. And by the way, many of those storms that day, there were a few that did have good tornado video, but only, I recall, maybe two at the most, maybe three, that had good enough definition that they made for good pictures, good video. Of the other 35 or 40 or 50, there was nothing there, nothing to take pictures of. It was dark, it was messy, and so it wasn't something that was worth going out to look for. So you have to kind of balance when you're looking at a forecast for a day coming up when it's going to be severe. You have to kind of look at the odds. What are the chances I'm going to see something? Is it worth driving 300 miles? Is it worth running around the country and then have a long trip back with nothing to show for it? So as you get older, you become a little bit more conservative. You look at the odds, you measure them, you decide, is this the one I want to commit to or not?
Well, thank you, Dave. We've covered a lot of ground today. It's something I've been wanting to do. I thought about it several years ago. We finally got it put together now. Unless you can think of anything else particular, I think we might call this the end.
I just hope you edit out all the hums and the haws and your nose, and you just put in the part where I just crackle along there.
Yeah, so that's, what is it, 74, 75-year-old mind of yours?
I'm 75 going on 74, maybe even going on 73 if I take care of myself. I got a treadmill over here. I work out on that. I try to 4 or 5 times a week. So I'm trying to hang in there.
And you told me, we talked too, that the ChaserCom in Denver this year, you've already registered to go to that.
For next February.
Yeah, 2000, yeah.
I just think, I don't, having gone for several years, and I kind of know what their format is and what they do, but I thought that this next year with, since Tim Samaras was one of the two founders along with Roger Hill, I just have a feeling like I should be there. I feel some obligation as the first storm chaser to show up, to express my sympathy in whatever way I should or can, and just to be part of that organization that meant so much to him over many years. And that's part of the reason for I'm going. Also, I hope to learn more about the El Reno storm. I'm assuming a lot of people who took pictures, and there may be some technical studies, maybe some research papers there that I would like to take notes from or collect, which will tell me more about what El Reno was like that day, because that was a very unusual tornado, very deadly, very special.